This morning, the British ambassador in Berlin handed the German government a final note stating that unless we heard from them by 11 o'clock, that they were prepared at once to withdraw their troops from Poland, a state of war would exist between us. I have to tell you now that no such undertaking has been received, and that consequently this country is at war with Germany.
On that fine Sunday morning of September the 3rd, 1939, when at 11 a.m. the Prime Minister announced over the wireless that a state of war existed between Great Britain and Germany, there were thousands of men living peaceably in the North Riding of Yorkshire who never dreamed that in the course of the next 6 years fate would lead them to widely scattered regions of the earth. Men from the Dales and from the rich central plain of York, men from the mines of Cleveland and from the industrial town of Middlesbrough, from the market towns of Thirsk and Northallerton, and from the seaside towns of Scarborough, Redcar, Whitby and Bridlington, all joined or rejoined the Green Howard family. Those who were too old proudly took up arms in 1940 as members of the Home Guard, ready to face any invader who should dare to attempt to put a foot on Yorkshire soil. Hello, my name's Paul Cheall. I'm the son and editor of my father Bill Cheall's Second World War memoirs, which have been published by Pen and Sword in Fighting Through from Dunkirk to Hamburg. You've just been listening to a bit of narrative from Captain W.A.T. Singe, who wrote a book called The Story of the Green Howards, and the book covers the entire period of the war, 1939 to 45. Before that, you were listening to Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain's Declaration of War speech in September 1939, and my dad was listening to that speech live on a wireless when he was camping with pals in Devon, and he had to beetle back up north quickly to join his regiment, which was a northern regiment, the Green Howards, and he was in his first car at that time, and more about the car and the pals he was with in future podcasts. Dad was in the war from beginning to end, and he was involved in several major conflicts, including Dunkirk, Sicily, North Africa, D-Day, ended up in Germany at the end of the war. And he was an ordinary soldier, but he had what I feel was a quite extraordinary war. And his war started off in Dunkirk, and that's the subject of this, my very first podcast. The aim of the podcasts is to give you snippets from the book, as well as some fascinating updates on his so-called band of British brothers, some of whom have written their own memoirs as well. So you'll be hearing quite a lot of great, previously unpublished history. Well, that's enough from me, and we'll get into the first part of the podcast. Thank you. Okay, this is the first chapter in Dad's memoirs. The chapter's called Looking for Bray-Dunes. Britain and her allies were at war with Germany. My B Company was part of the British Expeditionary Force in France. Germany had invaded the country and was now putting pressure on the Allied forces. We had orders to retreat to the coast, to a place called Bray-Dunes, near Dunkirk, in order to evacuate back to England. It seemed to have taken a very long time, but after some hours and 12 miles, we saw a cluster of buildings in the distance and added a little more haste to our walking. We were surprised that our destination seemed no larger than a seaside village. Eventually we came upon one main road through the centre of the village, rather shabby and uncared for, which was understandable. It looked just like Dodge City, but it was great to us. It was Bray-Dunes, and we were very pleased to have sight of it. But other troubles were very soon to descend upon us. We walked down the sand-blown main street, and at the end came to a small promenade overlooking the sea. Not a soul was in sight apart from our lads. We turned left and walked along this narrow promenade. It had a wooden rail along the seaward side, and there was a 6-foot drop to the beach. We stood and looked at the sea, which could mean our salvation. The other side of this water was England. Oh, that lovely sea, with England just on the other side. How simple. We walked to the end of the promenade, about 200 yards, which led onto deep, soft sand, followed by huge 6-foot sandbanks. The sea was about 200 yards away from the high water mark, and both east and west the beach was very flat. The accompanying sight which greeted us will forever live in our memories. On the beach, running both ways, there were many tens of thousands of khaki-clad figures, milling around for as far as we could see. But there was nowhere to go. And there were columns of soldiers 3 deep, going out to the sea, up to their shoulders, trying to get onto the small boats to take them to England. It was 30th of May. I don't know how, but we made our way to the water's edge and looked out to sea across the horizon, and saw the ships going to Dunkirk further along the coast. We then made our way back to the deep sand dunes in order to gain some protection from the bombing and strafing which was taking place. Many of the boys on the beach were in a sorry state. The Stukas had just been over. One must remember that not all soldiers are hard-bitten individuals, and some of the younger lads showed great emotion. I saw young soldiers just standing crying their hearts out, and others kneeling in the sand praying. It's very easy to pass critical remarks about these lads, but we others knew the ordeal these weaker-willed boys were going through, and we helped them as much as we could during their emotional and distressful ordeal, as medical help was a very scarce thing on the beaches. So much had been bottled up inside these young soldiers that at last the bubble had burst, and it was uncontrollable. Dead soldiers and those badly wounded lay all over the place, and many of the wounded would die. It was tragic to see life ebbing away from young, healthy lads, and we could not do a thing about it. It was heartbreaking. What few stretcher-bearers there were always gave of their best. They were extraordinary. How does one quantify devotion to duty under the conditions which prevailed in those days? The folk at home could not possibly have any idea what their boys were going through, and if they did, they would believe the war was already lost. There was no panic, just haste. We joined this mass of tired and hungry lads. Amidst all this tragedy, the Stukas would return, machine-gunning the full length of the thousands of men. They could not miss, and a swathe of dead and wounded would be left behind. Really, it was awful. Many of us fired our rifles at the planes, but they were useless. Nobody can imagine what it's like to be bombed by a German Stuka. They came out of the sky, screaming straight down, then dropped their bombs and pulled up into the sky again. I don't know why we ran. It was just instinct, I suppose. Near the shoreline, one boy of about 20, not far from me, had his stomach ripped open, and he was fighting to live, asking for his mum and crying. A few of us went to him, but he was too bad for us to help. Blood was everywhere. That poor boy soon died, out of pain, to join his mates. It's the most dreadful experience to see a comrade killed in such a way. Some young lads who had lost their nerve went crazy and lay on the sand crying. Others knelt and prayed. Mind you, I'm sure we all prayed in our own way. No one, of course, could help behaving like this. It was just because of the trauma they'd endured and had at last given way to their feelings. The near impossibility of getting back to England left many of us rather stunned, as it just did not look possible. Our lads, or what was left of our battalion, stuck together among the dunes to obtain some protection from the bombing and strafing. We'd had nothing to eat except hard tack biscuits and bully beef. We hadn't had a hot meal for God knows how long, and the lads who usually shaved looked really haggard. none of us could see any sign of the 23rd Divisional Assembly Area, and nobody seemed to know what to do for the best. Then the planes came over again, causing more deaths. Only 20 yards from me, some lads had been hit by shrapnel, and one of them was in a serious condition. The medics were there, but he wouldn't live. A sleepless night was ahead of us. There was no plan of action, and even the officers seemed to be showing signs of tension. At about midnight, we heard a plane coming, but it was not a bomber. It was dropping parachute flares, and suddenly it was as light as a day, and eerie and fluorescent. Towards Dunkirk there were dozens of fires caused by burning vehicles, and the flames from the burning oil storage tanks lit up the clouds. Very quickly the Stukas came over doing their killing, flying the length of the beach, and we dug even deeper into the sand. Lads on the beach were running all over the place, but there was nowhere to go. I don't know why God was allowing this to happen, yet I saw many boys praying to him on their knees. The morning eventually came, and we were very cold, hungry, and utterly miserable, but there was no let-up from our discomfort. I was beside Major Petch, and he said, "Come along, Cheall, I want to see if I can find somebody in authority to give guidance to us." From our elevated positions among the sand dunes, we could see more so the thousands of soldiers on the beaches. Most of them, at this early hour, were lying around on the sand, certainly wondering what the day would bring. It would take a miracle for us all to be lifted off. I can't recall seeing any signs of despondency, though. After all, we were soldiers, even if we were somewhat dishevelled, and only showed natural tendencies to want to get out of the predicament we now found ourselves in. Oh, for a mess tin full of tea! And for most of the lads, a woodbine. Around 1100 hours, it looked as though our officers on the beach were trying to organise the men. The Major and I went along the beach to try and find somebody with any news of what was happening about the evacuation. We'd walked about 1 mile when we met our divisional commander, Major General Herbert. He was collecting a column of our 23rd Division in order to proceed to Dunkirk to try and get on a boat, since there was no chance of us being evacuated if we stayed where we were. He told Major Petch to collect his lads and join the column with the utmost urgency. We hurried back to where our company was waiting to give them the news. In the distance we could see what must be Dunkirk. The 5 miles walk there, exhausted as we were, seemed like 50 on the soft sand, which played havoc with tired legs. Ahead of us I could see the oil tanks with black smoke and flames pouring from them after they'd been bombed. As we made our way along the beach, a fighter plane zoomed down to machine gun the men. Many of us knelt down and fired our rifles, without any success. We could see ships out at sea making their way from Dunkirk to England, and could also see the dive bombers after the ships. To our horror, many other ships had been sunk, their funnels and superstructures sticking out of the water. It was a ship's graveyard, and it looked dreadful. Eventually, our column reached the pier, or East Mole as it was called, and we waited in a long queue until it was possible for us to board a ship. Really, it's almost unbelievable, but even when we were attacked by planes, we didn't move, in case we lost our place in the column. The Mole was a wooden jetty, only about 5 feet wide, and 1,400 yards long. It was never supposed to have large ships berth alongside. Thousands of men had formed queues leading down to the sea, and were in the water up to their shoulders, doing their utmost to get onto one of the small boats, which very often capsized. Beachmasters had a very difficult task keeping some semblance of order, but by and large the lads just waited patiently for their turn to come until the planes came over. Those in the water just ignored the bombs. Where could they run? and anyway, the sea absorbed a lot of the blast. There was always the hot-headed lad who thought he had more right to get away, but the officers only had to draw a revolver, and they calmed down and accepted the inevitable. In the prevailing mood of many of the men, it was common to see groups of soldiers kneeling down, being led by a padre in prayer. There, by the side of the jetty, a ship was waiting to be loaded with human cargo. We walked along the wooden pier, and back came the planes, it seemed never-ending, trying to bomb our ship, but without success. We walked along for about half a mile to the ship we would be boarding. Miraculously, the mole was still intact, but there was a 6-foot gap in the planking where a bomb had gone through without exploding, and loose planks had been put across. Some lads, in their desperate hurry, chose to jump the gap with their full kit on. Luckily, none fell through into the water. Another 30 yards, and we came to our ship. At the top end of a gangway stood an officer, counting soldiers as they went aboard. The ship was a ferry ship called the Lady of Man. How could I forget that name? How lucky we considered ourselves to be. Out of all those thousands of men, we were being given the opportunity to be evacuated. It was almost impossible for men of the same companies to stay together, but that was no consequence at a time like this. The ferry was fast becoming packed with grateful lads. The captain would know how many men the ship could carry, but God alone knows what would have happened had a bomb hit us. I was lucky enough to be on deck to see what was happening, and it must have been very claustrophobic down below deck. I kept my eyes on the nearest Carly float in case the worst happened. The fact that we'd managed to get on a boat was no guarantee that we would reach England, because the Luftwaffe was doing its utmost to prevent us. As the ship was filling up, a padre came and stood on a ladder, called for silence, and prayed for our deliverance to England. At last, packed like sardines, the ship started to tremble, and so very slowly we pulled away from the mole. It was 1800 hours. Being a little taller than many of the lads enabled me to have a panoramic view of the whole length of the beach. How many of those boys would get back to England, and how many would be killed or taken prisoner? The beach was as crowded as ever. Then suddenly I saw a German fighter plane skimming above them, firing cannons. It reminded me of a row of dominoes being knocked down from one end. The dense black smoke from the blazing oil storage tanks still reached far into the sky. There was another loaded ship about 1 mile ahead, and suddenly I heard the Stukas returning, screaming down almost vertically. I saw bombs leaving one of the planes, and was certain our time had come, and this was the end. My thoughts were mixed with prayer and despair, as I prepared for what I thought was inevitable. How the heck did it all come to this? As the bombs came tumbling out of the sky towards us, my life flashed before me, and in an instant I relived every moment of my time since just before the start of the war, when life had seemed so good. Well, that's the end of the chapter. If you want to find out what happens next, Fighting Through, From Dunkirk to Hamburg, is available through Pen and Sword, Amazon, and most bookstores. For more information, visit fightingthrough.co.uk or penandsword.co.uk. I've built a website as a companion to the book at fightingthrough.co.uk. It has all sorts of photos and background material, together with updates on his so-called band of British brothers, where I've heard from their families, with many poignant anecdotes and photos about their fathers or uncles, etc. I hope to produce more podcasts covering some of these unpublished stories in future. So if you've enjoyed this one, please do let me know via the contact button on the website, fightingthrough.co.uk. Following now is a summary of Dad's War, which I hope makes you want to buy the book. Bill Cheall joined up with the Territorials in April 1939, and back then he could not have imagined the drama that lay in store. As a Green Howard, he saw the sharp end of Hitler's May 1940 Blitzkrieg, and was evacuated exhausted from Dunkirk. His next move was to North Africa, courtesy of the Queen Mary, to be part of Monty's 8th Army. After eventual victory in Tunisia, the Sicilian invasion followed. The Green Howards were ordered back to England to form part of the vanguard of the Normandy invasion. In the fierce fighting that followed the D-Day landing, with the first wave of troops on Gold Beach, Bill was wounded and evacuated. His comrade, Sergeant Major Stan Hollis, won the only VC to be awarded on the 6th of June 1944. Once fit, he returned to the war zone, and he finished the war with the East Lancs as corporal in the regimental police, keeping the peace in devastated, occupied Germany. For all this, he earned 7 medals and a wounded in action stripe. Bill was number 1 on Bren and Mortar at various times, while fighting in some incredibly bloody episodes around the world. On one occasion, he had to bury the shattered remains of a fallen comrade. When he wasn't fighting, he offered kindness to a German POW and found a case of Heinz baked beans in a bombed-out ambulance. He also did a host of part-time jobs, looking after a senior officer as his batman, dicing with death as a dispatch rider, and serving up good army grub as an officer's cook, including preparing a meal for Montgomery and Eisenhower. The book Fighting Through from Dunkirk to Hamburg is available through Pen and Sword and most bookstores, including Amazon. For more information, visit fightingthrough.co.uk, or you can go to penandsword.co.uk. And please do get in touch with me over any aspect of this podcast which interests you. Thank you very much for listening. This is me, Paul Cheall, saying bye-bye now.